Hello. In this video, we will see the neuromuscular junction. First, we will see the relevant anatomy, and then we will see the physiology of neuromuscular transmission. Let's get started. First, the anatomy. The neuromuscular junction, as per the name, is a junction between a neuron and muscle. This is skeletal muscle. It is made up of bundles of fascicles, which in turn are made up of muscle fibers. Now the neuron. The cell body of this neuron is located in the ventral horn of the spinal cord. Near the muscle, the axon branches extensively. Then each axon process innervates a separate muscle fiber. The whole assembly of the muscle fibers innervated by the axon from one motor neuron is called a motor unit. One more thing, the axon typically makes a single point of contact midway along the length of the fiber. This is neuromuscular junction or muscle end plate. Here the axon branches like a tree, and bulb shaped endings that finally contact the muscle are called buttons. And that brings us to the diagram that you are waiting for. This is the presynaptic membrane, which of course is a nerve terminal. This is the postsynaptic membrane from the muscle fiber. And the space in between the two is called synaptic space or synaptic cleft. The nerve terminal has a large number of synaptic vesicles. They store the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. Their fusion with the membrane occurs at specific regions called active zones. Here synaptic vesicles are closely clustered in opposition to the membrane. The membrane near the active zone contains voltage-gated calcium channels. There are also many mitochondria in the nerve terminal. They supply ATP required for synthesis of acetylcholine. Coming to the postsynaptic membrane, it contains acetylcholine receptors. These receptors are ligand-gated sodium channels. The postsynaptic membrane has extensive folding called postjunctional folds. They increase the surface area of the postsynaptic region so that more receptors can be accommodated. In between adjacent folds, we have secondary postjunctional clefts. These clefts lie immediately below the active zones. Moreover, the receptors are located almost entirely near the mouth of these clefts. Because of these strategic arrangements, the acetylcholine is released in the vicinity of the receptors and it acts rapidly. Now the synaptic cleft. It is space in between the nerve terminal and muscle fiber. It's filled with a meshwork of proteins and proteoglycans. Attached to them is the enzyme acetylcholinesterase that destroys acetylcholine. So this is the structure of neuromuscular junction. Now we will see the physiology of neuromuscular transmission. For that, we will simplify this diagram so that we can focus on physiology and not get distracted by complex anatomy. First, let's see synthesis of acetylcholine. The raw material required for its synthesis are acetyl coenzyme A and choline. The enzyme choline acetyltransferase catalyzes the transfer of acetyl group from coenzyme A to choline, resulting in the formation of acetylcholine. This reaction occurs in the cytoplasm. Then via acetylcholine hydrogen exchanger, acetylcholine moves into the synaptic vesicle. In the vesicle, the acetylcholine is stored till needed. Its release is initiated by incoming impulse. The impulse causes the opening of voltage-gated calcium channels. So calcium ions diffuse into the nerve terminal. They initiate a series of events that ultimately result in exocytosis of the vesicle. So acetylcholine is released into the synaptic cleft. Here it binds with the acetylcholine receptors and opens the channel. So sodium ions diffuse into the muscle fiber. If enough ions enter, an action potential is generated. The action potential then spreads over the entire muscle fiber and eventually leads to muscle contraction. How exactly the excitation leads to the muscle contraction is a topic for a separate video. The action of acetylcholine is terminated by two mechanisms. One is the acetylcholinesterase enzyme. It cuts the acetylcholine molecule into acetate and choline. The choline is transported back into the nerve terminal and it's reutilized for synthesis of acetylcholine. The second mechanism of termination of action is the diffusion of acetylcholine out of the synaptic cleft. Termination of the action prevents continued excitation of the receptors, so the muscle relaxes. So this is all about neuromuscular junction and neuromuscular transmission. Let's have a quick summary. Motor neuron originating from the ventral horn of the spinal cord branches into many processes. Each axon process innervates a separate muscle fiber midway along the length. The presynaptic nerve terminal has vesicles that store acetylcholine, voltage-gated calcium channels, and numerous mitochondria. The postsynaptic membrane has acetylcholine receptors, which are ligand-gated sodium channels. And the synaptic cleft contains acetylcholinesterase. Acetylcholine is synthesized in cytosol from acetyl coenzyme A and choline by the action of choline acetyltransferase. Then it's transported into the vesicle. When the impulse reaches the nerve terminal, voltage-gated calcium channels open. The resultant influx of calcium causes the release of acetylcholine into the synaptic cleft. Here the acetylcholine stimulates the receptor, causing their opening. So sodium ions diffuse into it and action potential is generated. The action potential then spreads along the membrane, eventually causing muscle contraction. The action of acetylcholine is terminated by acetylcholinesterase that breaks acetylcholine into acetate and choline. Choline is transported back into the nerve terminal for synthesis of more acetylcholine. Diffusion of acetylcholine out of the synapse also contributes to termination of action. That's it for this video. If you like blah blah blah, share, subscribe blah blah blah, comment blah blah blah. See you in the next one.